We pray, God, that you would stir up your Holy Spirit in us. God, soften our hearts to one another and to your work in us. Engage our minds with your truth. God, as I often pray, I pray that as we're preparing for this time, if there's anything that I'm planning to say that's not from you, that you don't want me to teach or say, just take it out of my head. If there's anything you want to happen right now that we're not planning, God, all of us, we just surrender to you. And our prayer to you comes from the words of Psalm 19. Lord, we pray that the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts would be acceptable in your sight. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. You guys go ahead and please be seated. I see we have a really smart group here tonight. As you were gathering and the sun was out, this was the right side to be on, wasn't it? This actually looks a little bit like it would have looked at Amy's and my wedding if we had done bride side and groom side seating. This was the bride side. This would have been the groom side. I'm really glad to be here with all of you this evening. I want to welcome those of you who are going to be tuning in later to catch this video online. Thanks for making time for this. I hope this is something that really is beneficial to you. My name is Steve Turnbull. I'm the senior pastor here at UALC, and I'm looking forward to this time of learning together with you. It is a little bit risky, isn't it? Does anybody feel like a little curious or a little bit nervous what's going to happen next? I'm sort of reminded, and I told some of the folks this beforehand, and now they're probably afraid I'm going to say it out loud, but I am. I'm reminded of someone that I used to work with, a pastor I knew years ago, and he said, you know, there's always a risk when you try to mix faith and politics. It's a little bit like mixing ice cream and horse manure. One of them gets a lot worse for the wear, right? So yet, I think that what we're going to do, hopefully, we'll be able to avoid the worst risks of that, and I think that what we're going to do tonight is actually really important. Because these are hard times that we live in right now. We're struggling with a lot of things. And I mean, you could set aside an entire global pandemic and having the West Coast of America on fire. These would still be hard times that we're dealing with right now. We're talking about this election season. But I mean even more than just the election season, this one particular cycle that we're in. I'm talking about a whole culture, a whole political climate that we're a part of right now. And people, nearly everybody I know says that they are struggling with this right now. It's not a left-right thing, not even a Christian or non-Christian thing. This is a hard time for nearly everybody. Friends I know in this church, across the country, friends I know who live in international contexts are looking at the politics in their country and also watching online the politics in our country and are aware of how hard this time is for many of us right now. And I think a lot of us are asking, does it have to be like this? Or can't there be a better way for us to do what we're doing right now? I think that there is. And you'll notice something as we spend this time together today. You'll notice that what I'm talking about is the manner of our engagement in our political climate right now. It would be really interesting. It would be fun, at least for some of us. It would be important to actually talk about some of the specific topics, the debates, the disagreements that we have in our country. I'd actually love to be able to have those conversations at some point. But what I'm going to be talking about today, you will notice, actually just kind of comes a whole level before any of that. I think it's logically prior to any of that, and it's also in our experience. It needs to be prior to any of that. And as I go into the topics we're going to cover tonight, I want to be clear about something, and I hope that you'll understand this. It's not because those specific topics and disagreements don't matter. I don't think that at all. You would be rightly suspicious of me if I were making it sound like we could all just hold hands and sing kumbaya and just be happy and pretend we all get along. That wouldn't be the truth, right? We have some important disagreements in our country, and the things we're talking about, they matter. And they matter because people matter. Justice matters. Race relationships matter. Unborn children and born children and their mothers and their families and their fathers and their income and their health care all matters. Structures of our country matter. Business owners and employees and health care, free markets and regulation, globalization and immigration. I mean, these are big topics. All of them matter because people matter, because people matter to God and they matter to us. My hope, and I actually am genuinely hopeful about this, naive perhaps, but I'll just go ahead and be naive about it. I am hopeful about this, that if we can learn and be formed in the kinds of ways that I want to talk to you about today, I think that that kind of learning and that kind of formation can put us in a position where we can talk about those other things much, much more effectively. So let me start by kind of casting this vision a little bit. It's really observing a vision that Jesus Christ, the Jesus of Nazareth, had for the community of his followers and continues to have. Let me share with you just a couple of verses that have kind of caught me for years and years. They come from right about the middle of Jesus' Sermon on the Mount, at the end of Matthew chapter 5, and he's teaching about how his followers will love their neighbors, which wouldn't be a bad topic actually for us to talk about, but I'm going to hold off on that one for a minute. But he says this in the midst of this topic: if you love those who love you, what reward will you get? Are not even the tax collectors doing that, people who they regard as being traitors? And if you greet only your own people, what are you doing more than others? Do not even the pagans do that? Here's the assumption in this teaching that I want to expose. Jesus thought that the community of his followers would be different than the community of people who don't follow him. Maybe that seems obvious, right? If there's a whole group of people who say, Jesus is my Lord, he's the authority in my life, I pledge my faith and my allegiance to him, I will take my values from Jesus and I will go his way. And there are people who say, nope, I'm going a different way. I get my values somewhere else. He's not in charge of my life. He's not Lord. You would think that the outcomes of those two decisions would be different. And Jesus seems to affirm that, right? There's another place where Jesus says, and this is another one that's caught me for a long time. He's talking to people about the way authority and power is exercised in the world, how hierarchy works in the world. And he says, you know that in the Gentiles, the world of the Gentiles, outside of our people, the rulers among them, they lord it over one another. They have like a hierarchical top-down power structure where power on top is not really concerned about who's on the bottom. And then Jesus says this line that I will never forget. Not so. Not so among you. There's a different way of life. You're going to live differently than if you were learning your life from somewhere else. Or one more example, because this is the one that inspires me the most and that I hope, and if you're a part of our church, I know we have some guests that are here today. If you're a part of our church, I hope this one will inspire you too. Jesus said to his followers, this is the way that everyone will know that you are my followers, that you love one another, right? That'll be the hallmark of the community of my people. Self-sacrificial love for one another. The same way that I've loved you, laying down my life for you, so you also will lay down your lives while you live, and perhaps even literally at some point for one another. Love will be the hallmark of my community. It's just meant to be a different kind of community, which should make us ask the question, how, why, where does that come from? Does it happen because Christians are all the most special people? You had to fill an application. You had to have a certain kind of SAT score. You had to be awesome to get into the Christian community. Most of us would leave, right? That's not why. It's not because we have the most charismatic leaders. We figured out the best community organizing strategies. It doesn't come from us. It doesn't come from inside of human beings. It comes from Jesus himself. It comes from the good news message of and about Jesus, which I'll be referring to as the gospel tonight. The gospel is the good news message of God's salvation for us in Christ that Jesus himself taught, and it's the words about Jesus. It comes from outside of us. And the gospel of Jesus saves us from ourselves and from forces outside of ourselves, from sin. And here's the thing that's really important. The gospel of Jesus saves us and it shapes us. It forms us. I'm going to use that word a lot tonight. The gospel of Jesus forms us. And it's important for us to understand that we are always being formed. You're always being formed by something. Nobody is ever exactly the same person that they were 5 years ago. You may be similar. You may hold many of the same views. You may hold them more intensely than you did 5 years ago. You may hold them less intensely. You could be a similar thing, more or less, or you could be a different thing. And it can be totally innocuous, right? Like, let's say you are a roller coaster rider. When you start riding roller coasters, what might happen is you become a braver roller coaster rider. It forms your affections and your desires. You start to want more of them. Or you're pretty smart and you ride one and go, no more, thank you very much. But somehow the things that we do, they all shape us. The gospel of Jesus shapes us, forms us. It is, in fact, our destiny as followers of Jesus to be conformed to his image. That's what the Bible teaches us in Romans chapter 8. The work of the Holy Spirit is that we would be conformed as many brothers and sisters in the family of God, that we would be conformed to the image of the firstborn son, who is Jesus Christ. The gospel forms us in Christ-likeness, but it's also possible to be formed away from Jesus, right? It's possible to be deformed. And this is kind of the application point. This is what I think is at stake for us in what we're going to be learning and talking about tonight. I am worried, I am concerned, I think that I am observing that our current political culture and our manner of participating in it brings along with it massive risk of deformation, of being formed away from the way of Jesus. And I'm not talking about left or right. I'm not talking about the particular policies. There may be some that are more and less Christ-like, and those are conversations I would love to have at another time. But I'm just talking about even the manner or the mode, the nature, the culture of our engagement. It's forming us. Our speech, our relationships, our patterns of thought, our patterns of action, the way that we view other people, the intuitions, desires, and immediate reactions of our hearts, I think are in serious risk of being deformed by the manner of our political culture. And as Christians, I think it's an opportunity for us to be eyes wide open to this and to be formed by the gospel instead. So here's kind of the outline for tonight. I'm going to explain how the gospel forms us in three different ways. It can move us in three different ways. I think the gospel of Jesus can move us from arrogance to humility, and from polarization to partnership, and from fear to hope. Right? From arrogance to humility, polarization to partnership, and from fear to hope. I want those things. I would love it if we all experienced humility, partnership, and hope. And I just, last thing I want to say by way of introduction, I'm a follower of Jesus. I'm a Christian pastor. I'm talking in this group that's gathered here right now in person, mostly to Christian people. Some of you, though, whether you're tuning in later or here as a guest perhaps, maybe you're not a follower of Jesus. Maybe you don't know what you think about Christianity. Maybe you're deeply suspicious of Christianity because it appears to you to be one more voting block that is at play in this upcoming election or previous elections. And if that's how you feel about it, if that's been your experience, honestly, I get it. Like, I sympathize with where you're coming from. I think that is the way oftentimes Christians have been portrayed, and maybe we've been complicit in giving that impression. Whether you are a follower of Jesus right now or whether you are not a follower of Jesus right now, I hope to explain the message of and about Jesus, the gospel of Jesus, and I want to explain how it leads, if we will believe it, if we trust it. When we put our faith in Jesus, I want to explain how that leads to humility, partnership, and hope. All right, let me start with the first one here, the movement from arrogance to humility. The gospel gives us a whole variety of gifts, and the first gift that many of us may be familiar with in the gospel of Jesus is the gift of forgiveness. In the gospel, we receive forgiveness for our sins and are moved from arrogance to humility. So let me try to explain what I mean by this. Christian people believe that they are unrighteous. Maybe you know that word, unrighteous. If I were going to say it a little bit more simply, Christian people believe that we are wrong, that we have been wrong, that we are very likely to be wrong over and over again in the future. And the religious word for this is sin. We are infected with sin. We commit sin. We sin against God. We sin against one another. Jesus himself was super clear about this. I could give you 1,000 examples. I'm just going to give you one. Jesus told this story. He said there were two men who went up to the temple to pray. One of them was a Pharisee. A Pharisee was an admirable religious leader who knew the law of God. Everybody, maybe not everybody, lots of people looked up to the religious observance of Pharisees. And the Pharisee goes to the temple and says, "Oh God, thank you so much that I'm not like all these other people who are not as holy and righteous as I am." And there's a tax collector who in Jesus' context was someone who was kind of a traitor, kind of a treasonous collaborator with the Roman overlord occupiers. They were kind of lower than low. The tax collector won't even lift his eyes. And he goes, "Oh God, have mercy on me. I'm a sinner." And Jesus says, that guy had it figured out. That's the truth. He's the one. And then what I love about this story is you can find it in the Gospel of Luke. And the Gospel writer Luke introduces the story by saying, "And now Jesus told this story to those people who were confident in their own righteousness." And then Jesus told that story. So if you are confident in your own righteousness, I am confident that Jesus wants to undermine your confidence, right? Jesus wants to steal our self-righteous arrogance. He doesn't want us all to have a bad self-image and beat ourselves up, but he wants us not to be confident in our own righteousness. Now, the problem is even deeper than that. Not only do we do wrong and say wrong and act wrong, we know wrong. Like, our knowledge, our minds are infected with sin. There's this kind of famous verse in the New Testament that says, it is as if we are seeing through a glass dimly, right? So we can see some things. We're not totally blind. Usually we have some spiritual awareness, some knowledge, but it's distorted. Or there's another verse in the prophet Jeremiah, who was inspired by God to speak a word to his people thousands of years ago, to ancient Israelites. The prophet Jeremiah said, "The human heart is deceitful above all things." Both of these truths resonate with me. I know that my own heart is deceitful. I know that I have seen through a glass dimly and continue to do so. That even the intuitions, desires, gut instincts, the things that just feel like they must be right, that even these things are infected by sin. Even our way of knowing is distorted. One thing that fascinates me is that we may or may not reach this same conclusion based on human experience. I think a lot of us think this is sort of obvious. There was a theologian years ago who said, the doctrine of original sin is the only Christian doctrine that can be proved by observation, right? Everybody's all messed up. But not everybody actually does draw that conclusion. There's one terrific example of this in the Bible. The person I'm going to talk about is usually known as the Apostle Paul. Paul is super famous for writing parts of the New Testament. In the book of Romans, he said this, all people have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. Christians agree with that. We understand that's right. That's exactly what we're talking about. But he actually didn't always think that. That's a conclusion that Paul reached after meeting Jesus and believing the gospel. It was the gospel that made him so humble. There's another one of Paul's letters to the church in Philippi where Paul reflects on his pre-Christian life before meeting Jesus. And he says this remarkable thing. He says, according to the law, I was blameless. Can you imagine saying that? Like, I had it figured out. I was doing okay. Now that I say that, I actually do remember knowing a woman in the church where I was an intern pastor. And when she was in Bible study one time, someone said, well, we're all sinners in need of grace. And she said, unironically, I've never sinned. Awesome. I would like to learn more from you. Although maybe not. Pretty delusional, I think. Pretty delusional, right? So if we're ever in a Bible study together, you know what not to say, okay? But here's what I'm observing. Some people play the comparison game and they feel like they're losing. They compare themselves to an external standard or to other people and go, I don't measure up. I have screwed this up, right? Other people, and that's been my life experience to a great degree. Other people will play the comparison game to some sort of standard or to other people and go, I'm doing all right. I feel like I'm winning. I'm a winner. You're losers. I'm a winner. That's how some people feel, right? And I think the line between arrogance and insecurity is razor thin. And oftentimes one is simply masquerading as the other. I think the gospel gives us a gigantic doctrine of sin when we encounter it. We get to learn just where the darkness is in our own hearts and how gracious God is. Most of the time, people who have come to believe in Jesus haven't experienced something like this. We know, we discover that we are broken, that we are sinful, that we need forgiveness. And it can come to us in a whole variety of ways. I've seen this happen in as many ways as there are Christian people in the world, I think, or at least ones that I've known. God does this in our lives in lots of different ways. But then we discover that God can forgive us and give us the gift of innocence that's not ours, righteousness that's not ours, forgiveness that we didn't deserve. And then that emboldens us to be more honest with ourselves about the darkness in our own hearts. We're willing to maybe be a little more honest in self-examination and go, oh man, I'm actually kind of worse than I even realized. And then we go, and the gospel forgives that too? Wow, God is so gracious. And then, like another year later, we go, I've been deceiving myself this whole time. And we're willing to look a little bit more boldly. And then we go, oh, and the gospel it even forgives that. And it's this like reinforcing cycle. The great Christian teacher, Martin Luther, calls this the happy exchange, the blessed exchange. The nature of the gospel of Jesus is this. Jesus Christ takes what's ours and gives us what's his. So he takes our sin and the wages or consequences of sin, which is death, and he gives us his life and righteousness in its place. He comes to die in our place for us and gives us his righteousness, gives us his status, and gives us eternal life with God when we did not deserve it. Thanks be to God for this blessed truth. Now, our participation in our political culture actually, I think, also offers us a kind of righteousness. It offers us the opportunity to enjoy being right. We get to have the right knowledge. We get to form the right opinions. We get to make the right choices. We get to vote for the right candidates. Everybody likes being right. We get to be right, unlike all those fools on the other side who are so wrong. We get to play the comparison game and feel like we are so much more righteous than they are. And at best, we can be a little bit charitable. They're confused. They're ignorant. They're uninformed. They're misled. They're misguided. Or at worst, they're pretty dastardly. They're pretty wicked. They're just selfish. They're just doing what's good for them because it props up their power or their whatever, even though it's bad for the country. Those awful people. Thank you, God, that I am not like those people over there, right? It can turn into a real righteousness game. But this is a terrible burden for us to have to bear. Nobody really wants to do this. This game does not end well. Do you know why this is a terrible burden for us to bear? To build our sense of righteousness on our rightness? Because nobody is actually right all the time, right? And so if we have to pretend to be right all the time, it's going to come back and bite us in the end. But that's what we have to do because there is no grace in our political world. There is no opportunity to be wrong and receive forgiveness. Can you imagine two political leaders right now offering forgiveness to one another? I mean, I feel like it's just about unimaginable. There's no room to be wrong. When our arguments are weak, we just shout them louder. So there's no listening to one another. So there's no humility. There's no concession. There's no course correction. There's no place for repentance. Christians, I think that if this is the case, and if we are participating like that, these should be like the warning lights. These should be, what do they call those lights on your dashboard? Idiot lights? Like when they come on, they should tell you something is wrong, right? These could be indicator lights or warning lights to us that we are participating in our own deformation. Because followers of Jesus will suspect that they are at least partly wrong, probably most of the time. Followers of Jesus will be curious. They will be open and eager to learn. Followers of Jesus will participate, sometimes passionately, in the political process because we love our neighbors. Because Jesus said, love your neighbor as yourself, including your neighborhood and your community and all of them, all the things that affect people who matter to God. We will participate because we love our neighbors and we want what's best for them, whatever that might have been, whether we already had the right answer or not. But if we find ourselves acting arrogant, if we find ourselves incapable of admitting the weaknesses and faults in our own positions, then I think we should start to get suspicious of ourselves. And we should ask ourselves if perhaps our participation in politics has begun to be motivated not so much by love of neighbor as we have begun to turn it into a righteousness project. So, what could a Christian do about that? What could we do that would help us to guard against this deformation and embrace the reformation process that the gospel of Jesus seeks to do in our lives? And there's a very simple thing, honestly, that many of us do very frequently. Here at UALC, we do it at least once a week, and some of you probably do it more often than that. I'm talking about the act of confession and receiving forgiveness. It's something we do habitually. Every week when we gather for worship, we confess our sins to God. We admit to God and to ourselves, for goodness sake, and to one another that we are not right, that we have been, are, and probably will continue to be wrong, that our hearts are prone to wander, that we have not loved God above all things, that we have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. And in the declaration of the forgiveness of sins, you know what God does not do? God doesn't go, eh, no big deal, right? God does not wink at our harmless foibles. God forgives our sins, our treasonous faithlessness, our acts and our failure to act that have harmed our neighbors. And God's word judges these idolatries, and then God's word says, in Christ, your sins are forgiven. And that is a transformative and should be humbling moment. A moment when the Holy Spirit works on us to put an old us to death in sin and raise up a new us to life. And the fruit of this gospel formation is humility. I think the gospel grows the fruit of humility. And humility is necessary. It is so needed in our culture right now. Humility is necessary for learning, right? Because if you already know everything, if you're already right about everything, you don't have to learn anything anymore. You don't have to listen to anybody anymore. You can just tell us all how right you are and give us all the answers. But the gospel grows the fruit of humility. And because of that, I think the gospel grows humility and advances humanity. I think it advances our humanity. I think when Christians who love truth humbly, when Christians engage political discourse humbly, the result is better insight and better ideas and advancement. I think Christians, humble Christians, could be the best citizens in the world. In an increasingly complex and increasingly interconnected world, I think humble Christians would be the people who would be set free to ask, how can we love our neighbors best? What's the best policy? What's the best form of governance? What's the best ideas? If I didn't already know them, that's fine. I've been wrong about a lot of things before. Let's figure out what's best. It grows the fruit of humility. All right. I've been talking about it a lot. Let's do it, actually. Katie and Amy, you're going to come back out and lead us in a little bit of music. And this, I'm going to tie this together with just some very traditional words of confession and forgiveness so we can actually experience this. And then I'll share the last couple ideas with you.
Restore my soul, revive my heart, renew my life in every part, reveal to me what sin remains, then lead me
try that together.
Restore my soul, revive my heart, renew my life in every part, reveal to me what's
lead us in a prayer, and then in a moment I'll invite you to pray out loud with me, and the words will be behind me when that time comes. Almighty God, all our hearts are open to you, and all of our desires are known to you, and none of our secrets are hidden from you. We pray that you would cleanse even the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, so that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Friends, the Bible teaches us that if we say we have no sin, we're just kidding ourselves, and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, then God is faithful and God is just, and he will forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. So please just take a moment right now for silent reflection before God, and then I will begin to lead us in a prayer that we will speak together. most merciful God, we confess that without Christ, we are in bondage to sin, and we cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your holy name. Amen. Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his Son, Jesus Christ, to die for us, and it's for his sake that God forgives us all our sins. In the authority of Scripture, therefore, and by the power of the blood of Jesus Christ, I tell you by his promise that your sins are forgiven and you have been set free for life in the Spirit of God. Amen.
Restore my soul, revive my heart, renew my life in every part. Reveal to me what sin remains, then lead me to
the gospel gives us forgiveness as a gift from God, and giving us forgiveness, the fruit of the gospel is humility, which we all sorely need. Those of you who have been joining us online, I hope you're warm and cozy where you are. Everybody here in person, the sun has gone behind the clouds or the trees over there. And one of my many bad habits as a public communicator is pocket preaching. My hands are in my pockets. It's also cold, isn't it? So my hands are probably going to stay here a little more than they are supposed to. Let me move here a little bit and get into the second half of what I want to share with you. The gospel also gives us two more gifts, and the second gift of the gospel is the gift of belonging in the family of God. And because it gives us belonging in the family of God, it can move us from polarization to partnership. Now, I just want to try to be real quick, if I can, about how the Bible teaches us about the gift of belonging as a gift of the gospel. You can see this all over the place in the New Testament. In Jesus' own ministry, there's a scene where he's together with a crowd of people. I think he's in a house, and his biological family shows up. It seems that they are there to ask him to cool it a little bit. He's getting a little bit extreme in what he's doing, and he's going to get himself in trouble, which turns out to be true. But Jesus takes this as a teaching moment and looks around while his mother and brothers and sisters are outside. He looks at the people who are around him and goes, look at all these people. These are my mother and my brothers and my sisters. I don't think he's trying to diss his biological family, but he is saying that I have made these people family. They're not just a bunch of disconnected individuals who all happen to know me. They belong to something greater now. This same idea is all over the New Testament, communicated by several different images. Family language is all over the letters of Paul. According to those letters, we Christians, we followers of Jesus, are adopted as sons and daughters into the family of God. We are co-heirs with Christ of the inheritance of the Father. In Romans chapter 8, Jesus is identified as the firstborn of many brothers and sisters. In fact, the Apostle Paul, in his letters to his churches, refers to the members of those churches, to Christian people, by lots of different terminology. One thing he never calls them is Christians, because that word hadn't really caught on yet. He calls them believers in many cases. He calls them saints or holy ones. But far and away, the most common term that Paul uses to refer to the people in Christ who are in his congregations is the term that we translate as brother or sister. He uses that word so much because family is a predominant image for his understanding of what it means to be a Christian. And by the way, I'm going to note this. This was also a very significant image for how people in the ancient Roman Empire understood their sense of belonging in the empire. The empire was one big happy family as long as you were on the good side. Otherwise, it was one big, bigger, unhappy family, as a matter of fact. The emperor was like the father. Everybody was, to some extent, like a child, children who were dependent on father emperor for provision and protection. And when Paul is using this image, he's helping people understand that they are joining a whole new kind of community that actually could get them in trouble with the community whose praises they are no longer singing, whose ways they are no longer walking. There's another image of this. Paul uses the image of the body of Christ to describe the church. If you're part of our church or you know the Bible, you've probably heard this before. He uses this to describe how Jesus is the head of the church, and all of us play different roles, hands, feet, eyes, ears. We all work together. And one of Paul's real points in this is that we all work together, and no part has more honor than another part. We're all equal together in the family, in the body. You may not be surprised to know that this was also a very common metaphor that was used to describe life in the empire. It was all one big, strong body, and the emperor, the Caesar, is the head, of course, and everybody else has a part to play, and not all parts have equal honor, for sure, and you can use your imagination if you want. When Paul says you're part of this other body, of which Jesus is the head, he's saying it's a whole different kind of belonging. It's a whole different kind of authority. It's a whole different set of values. I think it's fair to say Paul didn't invent the metaphor. He just crucified it. He just said it'd be a whole different thing. Now it's in the way of the cross and the cruciform love of Jesus. Okay, here's the application that's so important for us to recognize. Our participation in partisan politics will offer a way to scratch the same itch. It will play on our natural human tendency and need for belonging. We get to be part of a tribe, if you will, and it's a very hard pull to resist. It's a very natural human function. We get to be part of a group. And probably most of us here realize that we can very quickly get pretty irrationally attached to our groups. I'm looking at all the Ohio State Buckeye gear that is keeping us warm right now, right? I mean, there are lots of Ohio State Buckeye fans who are here right now. Let me ask you, is it like rational to be a Buckeyes fan? Well, I mean, if you like winning, then it's rational, right? Sorry, if there are any Michigan fans here, I apologize. In Jesus Christ, we're all one. But I think what's important is that none of us went through like a period of research. We didn't like weigh all the facts and consider everything and go, you know what? On balance, the best, most moral thing to do is to be a Buckeyes fan. We're Buckeyes fans right now because we were Buckeyes fans last week and last year and the year before that, and our parents were, and we live in Central Ohio and whatever, and now we're loyal. And if you ask a fan why, we could give you reasons, right? But the loyalty came before the reasons. The loyalty drove the reasons in it, and it strengthens our emotions. Politics can work in a very similar way. We have a group loyalty, right? And this is where it's important. It's not that the groups that we're part of don't have different ideas. They do. And like I said at the beginning, those ideas matter a lot. but I want to kind of open our eyes and sensitize us to the way that our sense of belonging can drive our emotional reactions and really form us, and I think has the risk of deforming us. We have strong group loyalties. And I think one of the really powerful signs of this can be found in negative campaigning. History will show us, and has shown us over and over again, that when we rally together against a common enemy, that can be super effective for group bonding. And that's not admirable, it's just true. And a lot of people on both sides of our current politics are motivated to a great extent by disdain and contempt for a common enemy. And I hasten to remind you again, this is different from disagreeing with people. Disagreement is good. Disagreement is how we learn. Disagreement is in pursuit of truth. I'm not talking about disagreeing with people. That's important. It's important to argue and persuade and learn. I'm talking about name calling. I'm talking about mocking and shaming and chanting. Here are some indicator lights. Here's those dashboard lights, I think, that we may be afflicted with at least this temptation. Have you ever had the experience? Do you ever get an emotional lift when you are together with other people on your side talking about the ridiculousness of the people on the other side? Right? That emotional lift isn't because you're getting smarter. That emotional lift is probably because you're together with your people and it feels good to be a group, and it works on our emotions that way. Do you ever find that you are being made to feel more energized about defeating the bad guys on the other side than you are genuinely inspired by the ideas and ideals of your own side? If you're ever in a conversation with people and someone on your side, someone says something critical about your preferred candidate, or they start to look bad, can you feel your emotions rising in that moment? A little bit of anxiety. How am I going to stand up for my guy or my gal? The hair on the back of my neck starts to stand up a little bit. I feel my heart rate going up a little bit because they've come after someone in your family. They've come after your person. It's not just about the ideas that you can talk about calmly. Your group has been threatened. Do you start to feel contempt for people who are on the wrong side of all these things, even when those people may be fellow followers of Jesus Christ? Now, I want to be a little bit humble even about these sort of indicator lights, because you may very well be able to explain some of these in other ways, and you may very well be right about that. I leave it entirely to your discernment. I'm not trying to judge everybody's individual case, but I think it's important for us to listen to this at least a little bit and start to ask ourselves, is it possible that the manner of my engagement and the manner of my communication, my conversation, has begun to form me or is forming us in ways that are not ultimately good for us? And let me tell you, as a Bible teacher, that the early Christians struggled with this too. Their identity as a Christian family was massively hard to implement. There's a really important scene in Galatians chapter 2 where the Jewish apostle Peter had been sharing table fellowship with Gentile believers, and then he pulled back from living life together in community with them when some other Jewish believers showed up, and he realized that his identity on this team was starting to be threatened by his identity with another team, and so he kind of lost track of what the gospel was doing in his life. But one of the most remarkable things about the early Christians, the movement of those who followed Jesus, was that they became a people, they became a community who crossed the boundaries that organized the world. And I think that they and the witness of the New Testament have more to teach us about healthy diversity in community across lines of race, class, and gender than any secular philosophy could ever give us. And they have handed down to us two formative practices that shaped them in this way and can continue to shape us in this way. And those two practices are baptism and the Lord's Supper. And that might not be the way you think about those things, but let me try to open a perspective on that. I want to read you just a quick little couple verses out of Galatians chapter 3. Many New Testament scholars believe that these verses are a kind of baptismal prayer or formula or liturgy, words that echoed something that the early Christians said and prayed when someone was being baptized. These are these words from Galatians 3. so in Christ Jesus, you are all children of God through faith. See the family metaphor? We're all in one family. For all of you who were baptized into Christ have clothed yourselves with Christ. There is neither Jew nor Gentile, neither slave nor free, nor is there male and female, for you are all one in Christ Jesus. They became a community that crossed the barriers that otherwise organized the world. And in baptism, they were given the washing away of their sins, and they were given new life, rebirth, but they were not born again as orphans. They were incorporated into the family of God. And a very similar dynamic happens in the Lord's Supper. To share a table with someone is an intimate act when it's a normal meal. How much more so when we are sharing the Lord's table together with other brothers and sisters in Christ for whom Christ died. I think this is why the Apostle Paul in his letters seems to have blown an absolute gasket when Peter pulled back from table fellowship with the Gentiles in Galatians 2, or when in 1 Corinthians 11, he found out that the Christians in Corinth, his beloved Christian friends, this church that he started, that these socially middle, upper middle, and upper class Christians had begun to celebrate the Lord's Supper separately from the socially lower class Christians. And to quote 1 Corinthians 11, those who had plenty were humiliating those who had nothing at the table of the Lord. And Paul says, it's not even the Lord's Supper that you're eating anymore, because you cannot eat the body of Christ and not be and betray the body of Christ at the same time. One of these constitutes the other. And they had begun to betray. They had begun to dine together as brothers and sisters and live together as if they were still separate. And in fact, we are going to share the Lord's table together today before we leave this evening. And you are going to be welcome at the Lord's table, even though your political views are tainted by sin. Isn't that good news, right? And I'm going to get to come to the Lord's table along with you, even though the manner of my engagement and lack thereof is also less than what God wants for me. And the other people sitting in other circles are going to get to come to this table, even though they are misguided in different ways from how you are misguided. We are all going to be welcome and made to be a people together at Jesus' table. Thanks be to God that Jesus makes us family. And I think just as the gospel bears the fruit of humility, it also bears fruit that we need that can be called partnership. We desperately need this. Christians, I think probably more than anybody else, will be open to collaborate with other people who belong to the, quote, wrong political party. We could reach a hand across the aisle and maybe find a different Christian hand reaching back across the other way, or maybe a non-Christian hand reaching across the other way to cooperate, because the people who are over there are not our enemies. And even if they were, Jesus told us to love them and to pray for them. And we will be suspicious. I think Christians will be natively suspicious when divisive tactics are employed on us. When politicians use slogans to try to motivate the base, to try to get us all lathered up based on our emotional group loyalties and on our common enemies. And we will be able to see through this. And we will say no to the name calling and the negative sloganeering, because Jesus has made us a different community. And it will not be so among us. All right, one more. And it's getting darker and cooler, and I'm talking faster. Thanks be to God for that too. The gospel gives us the third gift. The gospel gives us the gift of rescue from evil. And the gospel moves us from fear to hope. The Bible teaches Christians everywhere not to fear. One time Jesus was in a boat with his disciples and a storm came up and they were frightened and he was asleep. That's right, he was asleep in the bow of the boat, and he wakes up and he goes, "Why are you so afraid?" And they probably went, "Because of the storm, Jesus." But he says, "Why are you afraid?" Because he's going to calm the storm. Jesus says in another place to his followers, "In this world, you're going to have trouble." Maybe not how you would start encouraging somebody, right? But Jesus admits, "In this world, you will have trouble, but take courage, for I have overcome the world." Or one of my favorite, most applicable examples is after Jesus has been crucified. He's been raised from the dead, but his followers don't know it yet, and so they're still terrified. They're afraid. They're full of fear. And the Gospel of John says that they were locked away, hidden in a room, quote, for fear of the Jews, which means not all the Jews because they were Jews. It means the Jewish leaders who had gotten Jesus killed, and now they were afraid might get them killed too. They're locked away for fear of the Jewish leaders. Jesus shows up in the room with them, and he says to them, peace be with you, right? Fear not. Because even if a global superpower put its power together and persecuted and executed you as a form of state-sponsored terrorism, which is exactly how crucifixion was supposed to function, even if the most powerful force in all the world killed you, animated by real spiritual evil in the world, God will just raise the dead and launch the new creation. So fear not, for I have overcome the world. Jesus rescues us from the worst thing that could ever happen and takes away our fear. Our political culture also deals with fear and power, right? But our political culture is not really trying to take our fears away. It tends to revel in fear. It weaponizes fear. It uses fear as a tool of manipulation and motivation. Marketing studies all over the place will show that people are strongly influenced and motivated and will act in response to their fears being activated. And so political ads, like many other kinds of ads, and the rhetoric of our leaders are very often aimed in such a way as to activate our fears. But unfortunately, fear is not only a powerful motivator, it is a dangerous motivator. And politics, of course, is also about power. And this is not a bad thing. This could be a good thing. At their best, political leaders will steward power for the common good of all people. At their best, political leaders will want to democratize power to guard against the concentration of power that leads to corruption and tyranny. I feel like I could teach a social studies class on this, right? The best instincts of our constitutional republic have these kinds of aims exactly in mind. Unfortunately, we're not always at our best. And I don't think we're probably at our best right now. And so instead, our partisan political culture right now is characterized, I think, by a lust for power. And powerful leaders across the spectrum will promise us that we need to give them the power, that we need to give them more power so that they can save us from imminent danger. If we will put our faith in them, then they will save us and we will be able to fear not, at least until the next election cycle. But that's a false gospel, and it's a false hope, and it's a terrible trajectory, because fear, anger, and unhealthy collections of power can and have turned human beings into monsters and communities into mobs. And we are right up to and maybe a little bit across the line of seeing that happen before our very eyes. And so let me ask you, as I asked you in the first two gifts of the gospel, what might we be able to do? How could we engage with the gospel in such a way as to benefit from this gift, to grow in faith in Jesus, to release, in this case, our fears, and to learn to trust his power? I wish the answer were more complicated than the one I'm about to give, because that would sound smarter. But nevertheless, the answer is, we pray. We pray. We pray. We join together in intercessory prayer. We trust God to do what we could never do. We trust God to do what maybe it's not even wise for us to attempt to do. We admit when we pray that we are actually not in control, that we are not the greatest force in the universe, that we can't save ourselves, that we have real needs that we cannot meet and enemies we cannot defeat. But we exercise faith in God in the act of prayer. It may not be a coincidence that when Jesus teaches us in the Lord's Prayer to pray for the kingdom of God, that the third of the things he teaches us to pray for, bread, forgiveness, and deliverance from evil, save us, rescue us from evil. Let me acknowledge that the gospel bears fruit, but so does fear. Fear and the gospel both bear fruit. Fear will make people captive, irrational, and dangerous. The gospel will make people free, generous, and courageous. And more than anything else, the gospel fills us with hope. And I'm not talking about like fleeting hope. I'm not talking about scarcity of hope. I'm not talking about the kind of hope that can be offered or found almost anywhere else. I'm talking about abundant hope. Hope that cannot be defeated. Hope that will not be defeated because it cannot be defeated. Hope that cannot be killed. One time, they tried to kill this kind of hope, and 3 days later, God raised him from the dead. There is always hope. And that's not because that's a cool platitude that people like to repeat. There is always hope, not because of a platitude, not because I'm an optimist. There is always hope because Jesus is still alive. And I think we need that hope in our world. We need undefeatably hopeful people. We need hopeful people because hopeful people build a hopeful future. Hopeful people build the future because hopeful people believe in the future, because we believe in the God who brings the future. So the gospel of Jesus, I think, can form us in his way. The gospel of Jesus gives us forgiveness and righteousness in Christ, and so it moves us from arrogance to humility. The gospel of Jesus gives us belonging in the family of God, and so it can move us from polarization to partnership. And the gospel of Jesus gives us victory over evil, and so it moves us from fear to hope. And this life that is characterized by humility, partnership, and hope is available to anyone and everyone in Jesus Christ. And if you are here as a follower, if you are watching this video as a follower of Jesus Christ, lean in to the gospel of Jesus. Lean into truth. Listen to his voice. And lean out of, be wary of, watch out for the pull of the ways of this world, which come to us in thousands of ways, including a few of those that I've talked about here this evening. And if you are not yet a follower of Jesus, but maybe you would like to know that you can be forgiven, that there is righteousness and innocence that can be yours, not because you are right all the time, but because it is a gift of God, or you would like to be part of a grace-based culture crossing community belonging in the family of God, rather than suffering the ongoing insecure tribalizations of our world that lead to such hostility, and would like to know that there is such a thing as hope that is greater than any circumstance and a light that shines in any darkness that no darkness can overcome, then I invite you to put your trust in Jesus, who gives us exactly these things. You can trust him, receive life from him, and learn to walk in his ways now and forever. Thanks be to God. Amen. Let's pray.
Amen and amen. We are going to spend some time in prayer, and we just ask that after each prayer, you take a moment to respond in your own hearts. So please just take a posture of prayer, of surrender to the Lord in this time. Whether you want to sit or stand or kneel, we are praying and we are surrendering our hearts to the Lord. Jesus, we love you. We thank you. Holy Spirit, come and fill this place. Come and fill our hearts. We surrender ourselves to you, knowing that we are sinful, knowing that we are imperfect. Open us up to who you are, to what you desire for us as your children, as your church, as this nation that belongs to you, Lord Jesus. Unify us in the power of your Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit, soften our hearts and engage our minds. We want what is best for your world and for our neighbors. But we don't always know what that is. And truthfully, we don't always even want to know. But as your scripture says, we pray that you would lead us all into truth.
Almighty God and King, your kingdom is truly one. But our nation is deeply divided and profoundly wounded. Please, God, heal us. We pray that you would speak into life empathy and understanding, cooperation and creativity, and conviction for the common good.
Lord, we know that this world is full of injustice. We see it every day, and it hurts our hearts. And we know that it hurts your heart even more, Lord. Help us, O God of justice. We believe that you will do right. We believe that you are the God of justice who knows all. We know that this world is in your hands. Please cause your justice to be done among us.
Lord Jesus, you are the head of your church. You are risen from the dead and you are Lord. Please build us up and ballast your church. Stir up in us your Holy Spirit and let it be that we would honor you. Make us a witness to your salvation in this world. Amen.
Amen.